Hello again, and welcome to the fifth and final video in this series on glass, this material that's been around for thousands of years and yet, as I hope to show you, continues to surprise us. Well, we're in these final bullet points now in the outline that I gave you at the start of the series of videos. I suppose I should introduce my green screen background again. This is a construction made in Minecraft on the server that I share with my two grandsons, and there's a lot of glass in it. Just a bit of fun. So let's start on the biomedical sciences end. Our skeletons, as we live longer, have this tendency of wearing out. We get problems with our joints. The example shown on the screen, an artistic rendition, I have to say, of wear in the knee joint is something that a lot of people suffer from, knees, hips, all sorts of things as we get older. And at the moment, the solution to that is to replace the joint, and it tends to be replaced with prosthetic inserts like this. So it'll be a titanium alloy, for instance, will be bedded into the upper and the lower part of the leg in order to enable somebody to walk reasonably well thereafter. And there are a lot of people with replacement knee joints and hip joints, and in fact all sorts of other joints, finger joints and so on, are also entirely amenable to this sort of process. But what if we didn't need metal implants? What if we could encourage the body to grow its own replacement, to grow its own bone, to grow its own cartilage? Living tissue, new living tissue that belongs to the person. So no issues with rejection or wearing out or metal fatigue or any of those other things. Well, that's where I'm heading. And it's going to take us back to those pictures I showed you right at the very beginning of the series, illustrating how in nature glass can be grown chemically. So it doesn't need a furnace. We don't need to throw sand and soda and lime and so on into a vat and heat them up, melt them and make whatever we want out of them. Things like diatoms, the Venus flower basket that I showed you and so on, all of these creatures can make glass chemically from the elements that they grab from the environment around them. And I said at the time, if we could mimic that process, maybe we could do some really exciting new things. And that's exactly where we're going. So this is an area that my research group, in collaboration with several others around the UK and worldwide, spent the last two decades of my career attempting to develop and to understand to move forward in this area. So I'm just going to give you a little glimpse of a few bits and pieces that I was particularly involved with. So, you know, my end of this set of collaborations was actually to try and understand why the glass behaves as it does at the level of the atoms within it. So here's a simplified version of the chemistry associated with making these glassy materials. I can illustrate it fairly easily, I think, from this slide. This are colour schemes for these atoms changes, and I apologise for that. But on this particular diagram, our silicon atoms, which are still at the heart of this glass making process, are shown yellow. Now we've kept oxygen as red, and you'll notice that in this molecule there are four oxygens surrounding the silicon, but then we have a carbon and three hydrogens. So this is an organic compound, because of the presence of all these carbon atoms. And in fact, this is something called an alkoxide, and there is a whole family of these things. This just happens to be the simplest one, the smallest molecule that we can call an alkoxide. And these are liquids. These are liquids at room temperatures, room temperature. But we can do some remarkable chemistry with this. Now, I've stripped out a lot of the detail here. I'm showing you only the kernel of this process that's necessary to understand what's going on. And the key component in here is a humble water molecule. So oxygen and two hydrogens. Now, under the right circumstances, and this of course is the trick, this water molecule can interact with one of these alkoxide molecules and basically snip off this end bit. So we're actually left now with silicon, oxygen, and just a sole hydrogen left. And all the other atoms left over, so a carbon and 1, 2, 3, and 4 hydrogen atoms, now float off as this separate molecule over here. And those of you who know a little bit about chemistry, school chemistry will do for this, this is actually an alcohol molecule. It's in fact methanol. One carbon atom in there makes it methanol. So this is actually relatively easy to remove. We could evaporate this away and get rid of it. But the next step is actually the truly beautiful thing in terms of how important our water molecule becomes in this sense. What happens next is that we get a couple of these getting near to each other, and in particular this part of the molecule will come near to each other. This is a fluid, remember, so these things are just moving around all the time. There's a fairly good probability over time that we'll have a couple of these butting up against each other. And something remarkable happens then. We actually get the hydrogen molecule lopped off from one of them. We get a hydrogen and oxygen lopped off from the other. So in other words, we've got an oxygen and two hydrogens released. Here it is. So our water molecule that started up over there is now released again into this chemical reaction. It's behaving, in other words, exactly like a catalyst. And we end up then with a silicon going to this oxygen, which used to have a solo hydrogen attached to it, and its neighbour over here, but it's lost, remember, one of the oxygens and now two hydrogens. So we've got a silicon joining through an oxygen to another silicon. Now, remember where you saw that? Right at the very beginning of the video series. We've actually got the beginnings now of the creation of a glass network, a silicate glass network. All that needs to happen is for these molecules to continue bumping into each other so that not just this one here, but these other units attached around the outside go through exactly the same process. So a water molecule will be released when two of these come together, and we'll build another bridge, this time between this silicon atom, say, through this oxygen to another silicon atom in a neighboring molecule. And this is going to go on and on and on and grow in three dimensions, a network of silicon with four oxygens, two of which are going to be bonded through to other silicon atoms, a silica glass. So by this chemical process, we can end up with a three-dimensional glass, a silica glass. And because this is a chemical reaction that we can control, so we can control the rate of this reaction, we can control the other bits and pieces that we might add in here, and we can control even the size of this. There's no reason why this has to be the methyl alkoxide. This could be an ethyl, so two carbon atoms in here instead of one. We can do all sorts of things now to change this process and therefore change the glass that we end up with. And we can incorporate all sorts of exciting things now built into the glass at the atomic level. And this is an end result. This is essentially a foam of a glass that turns out to be bioactive. I'll tell you what that means in just a second, but I should probably just show you what this looks like in practice. So here's a bit of the material that you're seeing in the image on the screen. It's porous. It's actually quite low density. It's porous by design. We'll come back to that later on. But this piece of glass here has the ability, if you put it in bodily fluids, to tell the body to grow bone. Right, so we need to explore this a little bit because this sounds and is something with enormous potential. Well, let's have a look at our bit of foam now at a very expanded scale. So this is a bit of X-ray tomography. So this is like a 3D model, I suppose, of the material. And you can see that it's riddled with holes and pores, and all of them are interconnected. And we can, you know, just as we can control the makeup of the glass, so we can control the size and the connectedness of these holes. The red, I should add, is entirely artificial. That's just the colour scheme chosen in this computer rendition of the information. But these holes are important because, remember, what we're aiming for is a material that will be replaced in the body by new bone. So of course, if we're going to grow living bone, we need these holes and channels, because we need blood vessels, for instance, to be able to grow into and through the material that we're trying to generate. We've got to take nutrients in, we've got to take waste products out, and so on. So for this to be a living material, we actually need it to control these pores and to control them quite closely. So now we get to the nitty-gritty. This is what happens on the surface of one of these bioactive glasses. And remember, this is chemically, this is very, very simple. This is a silica glass, so silicon and oxygen, to which, in this case, we have added a bit of phosphorus, and we've added, crucially, we've added some calcium. Actually, you know, we've added calcium before, remember. In our conventional soda lime glasses, we added a lot of calcium to improve the working temperature. Calcium here is actually going to play a fundamentally different role. We're not melting it, after all. We're growing this chemically on the laboratory bench. But the key ingredient here is this little fella. This is a cell called an osteoblast. And osteoblasts are the cells that make bone in the human body, in fact, in all bodies that have bone. Versions of this osteoblast will be present. So they're taking the materials around them and organizing it essentially into living bone tissue. So this is a microscopic cell, but what it's growing on, and this is the fascinating bit, it's growing on some of this bioactive glass, so some of this chemically grown glass. And it's loving it. You can tell that by the way that it's spreading out on the surface and essentially making itself at home. So this glass has really remarkable properties. What it will do is to send a signal to the body to replace itself with bone. So osteoblasts will come and inhabit the surface of this material. And the ions released from this as it dissolves in body fluids, so, you know, there's another little unique property of this material, it will dissolve we can control how fast that process happens. If we get it right, then at exactly the same rate that this is dissolving in the body through its osteoblasts is growing bone in its place. So shape for shape, hole for hole, channel and pore for channel and pore, we will get this mimicked in brand new bone. So our bodies will have grown their own bits and pieces for replacements, basically. So it's a very exciting sort of process, as I'm sure you can appreciate. But the key part of this, this is a table you'll remember I showed you right at the very beginning of the series again, our network formers and our network modifiers. And I left this inscrutable at the bottom for these bioactive classes. But we can reveal a little bit more detail now. I'm still going to leave the numbers out simply because they are variable depending on precisely what we want this bioactive glass to do. But a lot of it is still going to be silicon, or silica, I suppose I should say, with the oxygen. Bit of phosphorus in there as well, but a small amount. Often sodium, but doesn't actually have to. The key bit is calcium, and there'll be quite a lot of calcium in there. We're talking about a few tens of percent calcium oxide will go in there. So quite high levels compared to what we've looked at so far. And there will be other bits and pieces, and I'll show you what the other bits and pieces might be later on. But these are the principal bits. We've got these two that are actually forming for us a three-dimensional glass structure. And this one here is the one that's doing all the legwork in terms of telling the body that it has something to do. So what it turns out is the calcium is released from this glass relatively rapidly early on, along with some phosphorus and along with some silicon. The glass as a whole is dissolving away, and these are all perfectly safe elements in the human body. We've got a lot of them built into our body anyway, so they're not going to do us any harm as they dissolve away. But this is the one that starts to send signals to the body, and it actually does that in some very subtle ways. As it leaves the material, it changes the surface charge of what's left behind, and that begins to attract other elements out of our body fluid. So, you know, blood plasma would be one to think of there, but actually saliva will do this job quite well. It attracts other elements in, the other elements that are going to be needed in order to produce bone material thereafter, or at least the mineral part of bone. But it also has this ability to upregulate a family of genes. Now that's vital, because these genes are now going to control what happens in terms of osteoblast activity, etc., around the place. All right, so this chemical signaling using calcium released from here is actually going to switch on, or upregulate at least, exactly the right family of genes for us to start growing bone. So amazing stuff. So that's fine and dandy, but there was a key and quite fundamental scientific question that needed to be answered. And we come back to our diagrammatic view of a diffraction experiment to illustrate this. There are all sorts of other experiments undertaken on this material, but this is the one I want to tell you about in this particular video, because it was vital to know how it was possible for the calcium to come out of that glass as readily as it did when it got in touch, in contact with body fluids, specifically body fluids at body temperature. So 37 degrees centigrade is where all this chemical reaction takes place. And for that, or one of the methods we used to try and tackle that problem was to go back to X-ray diffraction again. And in this case, we'd use neutrons as our probe rather than X-rays. I mean, we did some X-ray diffraction as well, but neutrons were key in cracking this puzzle eventually. So remember, what we're doing is we're firing our beam into our sample, be it X-rays or in this case neutrons, and we're measuring carefully what comes out the other side as a function of this angle here. So our detector in this simplistic view will track roundwards, and beg your pardon, our detector will track round and we'll measure how many neutrons come through as a function of the angle of our detector. And then we go through a little bit of manipulation of the data reduction, and a few mathematical processes, and we get, you'll remember, to this final picture here, which tells us how probable it is that we've got an atom at a certain distance from some other atom at the origin. Right, so we've got probabilities going up and down as we get more and more distant from whatever this atom at the origin is. And this information we can now put into our computer programs, into our computer models, and try and generate some understanding of what's happening here. So this is the actual experimental data. This is the experimental data that was gathered using a very particular form of neutron diffraction. And this is, well, this really is a rather neat little trick that we could use. The nice thing about neutrons when it comes to diffraction is that unlike X-rays, which scatter off the electrons around the outside of the atoms that we're looking at, a neutron will actually bounce or scatter off the nucleus, the tiny, tiny, tiny massive bit right in the middle of an atom. And that has an advantage because we can change the nucleus without changing the chemical that we're looking at. So in the case of calcium, there are different isotopes of calcium. So natural calcium will be a mixture of all sorts of different isotopes of calcium. And an isotope is just a form of an element that has a slightly different mass to its nucleus. The nucleus, you may recall from school days, is made up of protons and neutrons. And the number of protons is always going to stay the same. If we change the number of protons, we've actually changed the element. It's no longer calcium. So that's left alone, but we can change the number of neutrons in the nucleus. And it turns out that that changes very, very slightly the way the neutrons are bounced off the calcium in our glass. So the clever bit is to do two experiments on samples that are absolutely identical, except that in one of them, the ordinary natural form of calcium has been swapped out for calcium that is just one of the isotopes, in this case calcium 44, which just means the number of protons plus the number of neutrons in the nucleus adds up to 44. Right? Have a look at my video on radioactivity if you want to delve into this a little bit more. But I'm going to leave it at that for here, because that's a sideshow to what we're talking about. So you'll notice that these diffraction patterns are pretty much identical. They look very, very, very similar, and so they should. These are identical samples, really. The only thing we've changed is the nature of one of the atom types within it. But here's the clever bit. If we subtract one of these from the other, then all the bits that are identical, so the silicon and the oxygen and the hydrogen, will all disappear. will be separating like from like, they'll go. And the only thing left will be the information from our diffraction experiment that's associated with calcium, because that's the only thing that differs between these two curves. Okay, so here it is over here. Here is the difference between these two. All right, the noise levels have gone up because we're subtracting two things that are actually quite similar to one another. But nevertheless, you can see that there's a very clear structure in that difference. And it's this information then that enabled us to tease out the precise detail we needed about the environment of calcium in our material that answered the key question about how this material worked in the way that it did. So it turned out that our nearest neighbour atoms to calcium, which are always going to be oxygen, but those exist in three different types at slightly different distances. So the oxygen is a little bit further away in this one than it is from this one, and this has the oxygen closer still. Excuse me. So of the six oxygens surrounding our calcium, little over two of them on average are at this distance, and only one of them on average is out at this further distance. And that variation in chemical bonding in our material was sufficient, entirely sufficient, to explain how it was in body fluids at 37 degrees centigrade the calcium could come out of the glass as it dissolved at the rate that it did in order to upregulate those genes and start the creation of bone, or the mineral component of bone. The osteoblast will have to do all the rest of the work. So absolutely remarkable material, requiring some very sophisticated experimental methods in order to be able to understand it. But, you know, so much for that. We need to see what the proof of the pudding is, as it were. So here's some images that have come from one of the key colleagues that I work with on these materials, Julian Jones at Imperial College. Julian is still there with a large research group around him, and they're still working on some really quite important topics in this area. But this is an X-ray of a poor person who's had to have a piece of jaw removed, and that's sort of highlighted up here on our image. Let's not go into the reasons why that was necessary, but nevertheless, that piece of jaw had to be removed. And the treatment for this was to put in here, molded to the right shape, some bioactive material that would go through the sort of processes that I was talking about earlier, dissolve away, excuse me, at exactly the rate that the body could regrow bone material. So take an X-ray of that same person's jaw 6 months later, and you can see that we have bone that has grown. It's grown to the right shape because the bioactive material that went in there was made to the right shape, but it's fully integrated into the jaw, and why wouldn't it be? This is bone. This is actually the patient's own bone, grown by the patient, mending the jaw. Remarkable. Now, hopefully, not many of us will have to go through procedures like this, but the stuff we can get off our pharmacist shelves very readily that will do exactly the same thing, but in the context of our teeth. Now, as one gets to a certain age, and I confess I have long since entered that certain age, our teeth can become a little porous. So if we look at the surface of our teeth under a microscope, we get these tiny sort of tubules that go through the outer layers of the tooth and can allow acids or sensations of hot and cold. I mean, that's probably the first thing you come across, but certainly the acids created when we've eaten something sugary, for instance, to get towards the parts of the tooth that can feel discomfort, can feel pain. So that's a bit of an issue. Now, there are all sorts of toothpaste out there that will clog up these holes on a temporary basis, and they work reasonably well. But what if you had a toothpaste that contained some of this bioactive, chemically grown bone producing material, bioactive glass? Well, you can buy toothpaste with this material in it. And again, if we look at the surface of the tooth through a microscope after we've been brushing with this this sort of material, the holes are gone. They've been filled up with bone like mineral, exactly the same as your teeth would be expecting to have in them. So sensitivity is reduced quite markedly. Now, if you want to buy some of this stuff, I'm not going to advertise the brands in this talk. It won't be listed on the contents as glass. People tend not to buy toothpaste that they're told includes glass. It will be listed as a phosphosilicate glass of some form or another. So have a hunt around, but you know, if you're interested in this sort of toothpaste, it's out there. You can buy it quite readily and use it yourself. But we can do more. So we can do more even with the toothpaste. So I said, you know, we could add things into this glass. There was a column right at the end of our table on the right hand side that was headed other, right? So one of the others that you could put into this material would be fluorine, for instance. So now we've got a fluoride bioactive toothpaste. Even better, many would say. But we can do other things as well. We can incorporate metals. So copper, more importantly, and certainly the pictures on here are showing this, would be silver. Both of them are antibacterial. Silver is known, you know, even in consumer products as having antibacterial properties. You can buy socks that claim to have silver in them, which, you know, prevent foot odors and that sort of thing. But we can build silver into our chemically grown glass. And this is a picture. It's got biological staining in it, but essentially we're looking at a glass down here on the bottom and a biofilm, so a layer of biological molecules on the surface. And you can see that where they're coming into contact or near contact with our glass that has silver built into it, they're dying off. That's what the red is showing. These bacteria are being killed off. So there's the potential here for coating things in a very thin, I mean, we are really talking about microscopically thin layer of this chemically grown glass that will prevent bacteria formation and growth on the surface. But there are even more exciting things that we can do. This looks a fairly ordinary chunk of glass here, but it's another one of these glasses that is absorbable into body fluids. So it would be referred to as a bioresorbable glass. So exactly like the sort of stuff we've been talking about so far. But this one is much more based on phosphorus than it is based on silicon as its glass forming element. But we can do the same thing. We can grow this chemically, and this sort of button of glass has been grown chemically by that process. But we can include all sorts of things in here because this is a fairly low temperature process. We don't you know, we don't warm the thing up to get rid of our alcohols and so on, to dry it off in the way that we did with the earlier one we looked at. This can be dried at very low temperatures, so we can put quite complex molecules in there. And one of the things that we can put in are medicinal chemicals like this one shown on here. This is the chemical makeup of a drug called cisplatin. It's got that name because it's got platinum in the middle of it, so hence cisplatin. This is an anti-cancer drug, so this will be used in chemotherapy. It's been used for years, in fact, in chemotherapy for some forms of, for some tumours. But we can actually build this into the glass at the process of making the glass in the first place. So this molecule is going to be incorporated at the atomic level within the glass. But these things dissolve at a controllable rate in body fluids, remember. So we can actually get this cisplatin and molecules like it, we can do this with antibiotics as well, to come out of the glass, to be released essentially as the glass dissolves. So this opens up the prospect, for instance, not only with anti-cancer drugs but with the antibiotics that I mentioned as well, of being able to put small beads or rods of this material into the body, you know, through a biopsy needle, for instance, to the specific site where you need these molecules to be released in high concentration. So the body as a whole might be getting a very low dose, but the site that needs the treatment will actually be getting the maximum concentration of this material. So again, that's quite an exciting potential development in biomedical sciences, and all based around this process of growing glass chemically and incorporating in it at that stage all these exciting atoms and molecules and so on. So let's move on. We've talked about the biomedical side of this, but actually there's a lot of stuff at the well, I suppose more esoteric end of physics that we could talk about as well. You'll probably remember back in 2012 the announcement of the discovery of the Higgs boson. That's, well, it's not exactly old news now, it's very exciting news, but the only point I really wanted to make is that the detectors used at CERN to pick up all the stuff spraying out of these high energy collisions that are going on in the CERN ring are scintillator detectors based upon glass. So their core component is a glass. I'm not going to dive into this because I don't think I need to. I'm just making the point that, you know, glass comes up everywhere, even in really sophisticated sort of experiments like that. But more recently, we've had the detection of gravity waves. So this is, you know, a couple of years old now, and marching forward at a very fast rate, and provided a fantastic confirmation of Einstein's general theory of relativity. So you'll remember, I'm sure, from all the press coverage of gravity waves that they are literally ripples in space-time, and they've been caused because two very massive objects have collided or merged somewhere out in space. So it could be a couple of black holes, or it could be a couple of neutron stars that have you know, were rotating around one another, but eventually got close enough that they've merged, they've collided. And those events are so energetic that they actually cause the very fabric of space-time to ripple, and those ripples travel outwards from wherever that event happened, They travel outwards at the speed of light, essentially. And we can pick them up with a very sensitive piece of equipment called an interferometer. And an interferometer relies on mirrors. We need to be able to bounce light along some quite long pathways. And if we're going to do that and measure some very small changes, which gravity waves would induce, I don't suppose you or I felt these gravity waves going through the Earth, but they did. These mirrors were made of cylinders of ultra pure silica glass, and there's one of them shown suspended in this frame here. In the instrument themselves, they're actually suspended inside the detector vessel on glass fibers, so you know there's no metal framework around them, as you see in the in this test rig here in the laboratory. This is actually in the Gravity Wave Research Group at the University of Glasgow, which I had the immense pleasure and privilege of visiting just, you know, in the same year that the first gravity waves were generated. I was up there a little bit before that first discovery was announced, for instance. The head of that group, Professor Sheila Rowan, is pictured here. She's now the chief scientific advisor for Scotland. So she's sort of doubling up on her role as the head of gravitational waves group at Glasgow University, with her work now for the Scottish Assembly. But, you know, as I say, it's this cylinder of pure silica glass that was at the very heart of the instrument that discovered these gravity waves. Well, glass gets used in other ways as well. We're all familiar with lasers in everyday life. You know, we have lasers built into our Blu-ray players and our CD players and so on, for those of you that still have CD players. But we can actually make lasers of extraordinarily high power, mind-bogglingly high power. And there's a quote here from the Central Laser Facility at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory in Oxfordshire here in the UK, which sort of tells you a little bit what this is like. For a very short period of time, we can get enormous power deposited into one beam of light, and do some remarkable pieces of science as a basis. But this all depends on having a huge laser, and in this case we're talking about a laser called Vulcan. So if you want to go and look up Vulcan at the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, that's enough. If you put that into Google, I'm sure to come up with the result. But part of that is this really specialised piece of glass. And I'm going to switch cameras now so you can see this in a little bit more detail. Okay, so here we are. Here's the thing that was shown in that photograph in the slide. It's jolly heavy. You can sort of get a feeling for its thickness from the size of that steel frame around it. It's a very pure glass. Let me move this magazine underneath and you'll get a better view. So it's got this sort of pinkish colour, and it's this colour because it's got some erbium in it, right? So this is a rare earth metal. And you remember when we looked at neodymium in glass in an earlier video, we looked at its use in fibre optics as an amplifier or a switch for optical computing and that sort of thing. Well, this is similar. That was neodymium, this is erbium. They're actually going to do something analogous. What we need to do, of course, for a laser is to bounce light waves between components that will amplify the signal. That's how we get our really powerful laser coming out the other side. Well, this is one of those components. So we're not talking about fluorescence here, as we were with the neodymium vase that I showed you, for instance, or indeed the uranium glass that I showed you. This is doing something at, you know, different energy levels, but it's doing something analogous. So this glass is an integral component to the Earth's most powerful lasers. I have to say that this isn't a usable component anymore. Originally, this would have, you know, cost many thousands of pounds. It's an extraordinarily pure, large chunk of erbium-doped glass. But unfortunately, after a while, they'll tend to go through some sort of thermal cycling shock, and cracks will start to develop. And if I move this over, you can probably see that now against the white background. There is a crack that's begun to form in the surface layers of this glass. So it's completely useless now as a component in a high-power laser, which is why the people at the Central Laser Facility very, very kindly let me have it for my talks on glass. So I'm ever so grateful to them. This has travelled all over the place and done sterling work. However, it's heavy, so I tend to not take it on big trips. So let's put this back to one side and we'll swap back to our main camera. So we'll move on from lasers now to another intriguing material. This is something called an aerogel. And we can make an aerogel glass in the same sort of way that we made the bioactive glass. So it's a chemical process, in other words. But we end up with something that's utterly remarkable. And I need to just change cameras again. No, maybe we'll stick with this one and I'll just hold it up here in the hope that you'll be able to see it. It's highly porous. This thing I'm holding is very light and very fragile. It used to be a much larger piece, but unfortunately a member of the audience of one of my talks in the past picked it up and squeezed it without realizing, and it shattered into smaller pieces. So here we are. But this has about 1/2000th of the density of a conventional window glass. So it really is very light, very low density. Now that means this is actually one of the very best insulators on the planet. And the picture on the right hand side of the screen there sort of illustrates that. You could heat this up to incandescent temperatures and you better hold it by the corners because nothing is going to, you know, conduct through to your fingers. Really good insulator, but it has even more exciting benefits for science than that. And one of the fascinating things that can be done with a material like this was typified in this NASA Stardust mission. Now, when you get impact of high speed dust particles in space, they tend to do a lot of damage. They will smash at sometimes tens of kilometers a second into a satellite or whatever it might be, and they will, you know, they'll vaporize in that process and leave behind a lot of damage. They leave behind holes and so on. So they're bad news for satellites and so on, and very difficult to study because it's hard to catch a dust grain that's traveling at 10 or 15 kilometers per second. But you can using an aerogel. Because this is such low density, the particle will be slowed down gradually as it goes into it. So it doesn't vaporize in that process. the energy is being released a lot more slowly as this particle slows down. So the Stardust mission had this panel built onto it with a lot of little squares of aerogel glass held in this sort of honeycomb lattice. And here it is, here's the real thing when it came back again. And you can see that a lot of those rectangles are still filled with aerogel. So the point now is to examine each of these in detail to see whether they've captured space dust. So we have a look at one of the aerogels carefully, and you'll see that it's quite possible under a microscope to see that something has smashed into its surface and it's burrowed all the way down, being slowed as it goes into our aerogel material. So let's zoom in again. Right, here's where the particle went in at the surface of the glass. It's come all the way down, slowing, slowing, slowing until it comes to a stop. And this, our final zooming in, this is the particle of space dust that our aerogel captured. And in this case, it's captured it from the tail coming off a particular comet, so this Wild 2 comet. So we've essentially captured a part of a comet and then brought it back to Earth. That honeycomb panel was brought back to Earth and recovered. So really quite interesting stuff. Well, okay, so this is the fun bit that I wanted to go into to finish off the talk, really. You know, one of the things we'll all have perhaps seen, but certainly heard about, is breaking wine glasses. And, you know, the classic thing is, can you do it with a human voice? Well, yes, you can. It takes a very particular human voice. And if you look on YouTube, you'll find examples of this being done. But I'm just going to show you a more controlled example of it. This was undertaken by a colleague of mine at the School of Physical Sciences at the University of Kent. So I'm just going to play this short video clip and you'll see what's happening, and then I want to pick up some of the reasons that it's happening. Okay, so that was fairly unpleasant as a noise. But what's happening here is that this wine glass, and it's not a cheapie, it's actually quite expensive lead crystal wine glass, is being bombarded with sound from this speaker horn here. And there's a little straw being placed in there, and that's only there to show you that the glass itself starts vibrating. So it shakes this straw around, basically. And it's shaking because the frequency of the note that's coming in is the same as the natural frequency of the glass. It's resonant frequency. And so the sound essentially within the glass material is building up and up and up and up. It's like pushing a child on a swing and getting the push timed at precisely the right moment so that you build up the amplitude of swing of the child. And this is doing the same thing. This is doing the same thing with sound waves and the glass. So eventually those vibrations build up to a point where mechanically the glass can't take it anymore, and it pulls itself apart because of those vibrations. And of course, that's what we saw at the end of the video. Now, how do we know what frequency we need to put into this glass? Well, actually, it's that note there. Let me move this a little bit closer in case it didn't come out well. Whatever note you get as you ping the side of your lead crystal wine glass is the note that you need to put in order to get it to shatter. So if your voice can do that, you can shatter a wine glass. Well, moving on, one of the things that that I quite often get asked about glass is this myth, and it is a myth, that old windows are thicker at the bottom. So by old windows, we're talking about, you know, things like medieval stained glass windows in churches or in National Trust historic buildings, that sort of thing. They're thicker at the bottom because the glass is flowing, because glass isn't a proper solid, it's just a very slow moving liquid. Well, that's a myth. Now, you will find that in textbooks. I've seen it in school textbooks. It's completely wrong. By any reasonable definition of what a solid is, a glass, as in glass window panes and so on, is a solid. So no, it's not because the glass is flowing. There can be a little bit of chemical effect. You get weathering for some of these old glasses, and it will leach out some things from higher up the pane and then deposit them again at the bottom. But that's a minuscule effect. No, this is simple engineering. You remember when I told you about forming glass sheets before we got to the float glass process that Alistair Pilkington developed in the 1950s. We would have a glob of soft glass on the end of a pole pulled out of a furnace, remember, that would be spun, and so we'd end up spinning a disc of glass outwards. And then those circles of glass would then be cut up to form different pieces of glass that could then be used in making of leaded windows, for instance. Now, how are you going to put a piece like that into a window, into one of the rectangles in a leaded glass window, for instance? Well, you're going to put the thicker part at the bottom, because it's more stable. And there will always be a thicker part, because as you spin this out, you've got thicker in the middle, thinner on the outer edge. That's just a function of spinning things around. So no, it's got nothing to do with the glass flowing. It's got everything to do with the way the glass was made and the sensible window makers who put the thicker bit at the bottom. Why is glass transparent is another question that, you know, comes up periodically. Well, actually, you know, glass is reasonably transparent, but it's not perfectly transparent. And it depends on the sort of glass that you're looking at and how much of it you're looking through. So let's see if we can pick this out with a little bit more clarity here. So I've got a rod of glass made up of three different glass types. Let me put another white background underneath this so that we can see this, I hope, with more clarity. Oh, there we are. So in the middle, I've got an ordinary soda lime glass. Around it is Pyrex, which you remember is technically a borosilicate glass. And on the outside is pure silica. So just silicon and oxygen, sand, that has been formed into a tube at very high temperatures, remember. Silica requires temperatures of, you know, over 1500 degrees centigrade in order to melt. And you'll notice a very big difference. You know, whilst all of these look transparent, if we only look through a little bit of them, if we look at them lengthways on, in other words, we try and look through more of the material, you'll notice they're not, you know, there's not a lot of transparency at all in the soda lime glass in the middle. In fact, it looks sort of green. And you might well have seen that before. If you look at the edge of a piece of window glass rather than looking through the thin cross section of it, you'll have seen this green colour. So glass is transparent up to a point, but is not perfectly so. And around the outside of that is Pyrex, and that's, you know, that's better, but it's not perfect. And the one that looks clearest of all, that's actually much more difficult to see on this shot. I'm just going to take it up a little bit closer, although we go out of focus sadly. That pure silica is actually the more transparent of the lot. And that's, of course, that was at the heart of the development of fibre optic glass, for instance, for the fibres used in optical communications and so on. They had to be extraordinarily transparent because you couldn't afford to lose a lot of light as it travelled over kilometres of this cable. So glass is transparent. Up to a point. Some glasses are more transparent than others, and of course the reason they've got transparency at all is because, quite simply put, there's nothing in there to absorb the energy of the light. So it just carries on travelling through. So unlike a metal, for instance, which will absorb pretty much all light that you throw at it, a glass won't. It's got no mechanism within it to take the energy out of the light and absorb it. We can show the difference between different types of glasses in other ways as well. I'm going to try and illustrate it with this set of mock wine glasses that I've got here, made by a glassblowing friend of mine, but I'm going to switch back to our other camera in order to do that. So here we are. They're pretty much the same size and shape and so on. They're not identical. Glassblowing isn't that perfect, but it just shows you a difference between them in terms of, I'm going to do it in terms of sound now. So if I ping a soda lime glass, it's fairly dull, right? This is lead crystal, slightly clearer, goes on for a little bit longer. That's pure silica, which is actually very hard in terms of glass blowing, believe me. But you'll notice that's louder and it goes on for longer. What's the reason for that? Well, it's a little bit like light going through. It depends on what's there to absorb the energy, in this case to absorb the energy of the sound. So in our soda lime glass we've got lots of these light atoms, things like sodium, floating around, and they'll just mop up any sound energy going, which is why it sounds so dull. In lead crystal we've got obviously a lot of lead atoms, and they're so heavy, so massive, they actually really don't mop up a lot of the sound energy at all. They're just too massive for that, so that tends to sound clearer and go on for longer. In our pure silica, of course, we've got none of this stuff cluttering up our glass network. This is just a three-dimensional network of our glass forming silica, and that's why the sound goes on a lot longer, because there's less in there that's going to absorb it. So here we are, essentially at the end of this fifth and final talk. But what I thought I'd show you at the very end is just, you know, some rather pretty bits of glass that we can find pretty much on any beach that we come across. This is standard commercial domestic glass that has been well, lost at sea, I suppose we could say most kindly. It's litter, actually, but it's been rolled around in the sea, it's been polished and smoothed and so on, so we end up actually with these rather attractive glass beads on the seashore. So there's no science in there particularly, it's just nice to look at and something that you can go and find at any old stage. So we're pretty much at an end now. This is a cartoon one of my research students did some years ago now, just to illustrate who was in the research group at that time. It's not hard to discern what she thought was the most appropriate character to represent me. I'll let you work that out. But the people who funded a lot of our research are shown down at the bottom. And of course, you know, research costs money. These folk all needed paying, and quite rightly so. So we've come to the end now. We've had 5 videos, all on the topic of glass. We've looked at what a glass is in terms of its atomic arrangement. We've looked at how it's made in a conventional sense, what happens to it when we start playing around with that recipe, the interesting things that come out of it, colouring glass for instance, or tuning its properties to make things like Pyrex, for example. We've looked at its use in architecture, in engineering, in science, so, you know, microscope lenses, that sort of thing, and followed it all the way through to some really more cutting edge stuff, like the bioactive glasses, like the use of glass in some of these incredibly groundbreaking types of experiments, the discovery of the Higgs boson, the discovery of gravity waves, for instance, and in space research. So all the way through, we've seen glass as the common component. It's enormously valuable as a material. It has a range of uses that, you know, defies limit, really. And its uses, its characteristics, its potential is continuing to grow, to expand, and to excite. So I hope you found some interesting things in these talks. I love talking about glass, and I hope you have enjoyed learning a little bit about it.